Brian Thomas, pleased to welcome, and the Rob Portman seats up for grabs. If you haven't noticed, there are quite a few options for you as we head to the primaries, and they are rapidly approaching, going to be upon us in no time. One of those candidates, Mike Gibbons, would like your vote for U.S. Senate. Welcome to the program, Mike. It's a pleasure to have you on the 55 KRC Morning Show today.
Thanks for having me, Brian.
And for those who aren't familiar, it's Gibbons, G-I-B-B-O-N-S, Gibbons4Ohio.com. That's his website. Very informative website. I'll give you a praise on that one, Mike. You clearly articulate your goals and your ideas. And one of the things that it seems to me that Texas and Florida both have some sort of magical recipe for attracting business and industry and jobs. People are fleeing the outrageously high taxation states of California and New York and heading directly to those two states. What magical recipe, Mike Gibbons, do you have to perhaps, I know as U.S. Senator, you know, you're dealing with much broader national issues, but Ohio's, you're a job creator. You have been a businessman your entire career. What does Ohio need specifically, dealing with the needs and interests of our state, to transform it into a magnet for jobs as opposed to a state from which businesses are fleeing to other states?
Well, we could take up the whole interview with this because there's a lot to be talked about.
I understand.
You start with the cab tax. Where you tax a business on revenue, not on that income. It's antithetical to trying to encourage business. It just kind of sends a message to any business that comes to this state that you're going to have to pay taxes. Even if you don't earn anything, revenue is not income, and just to add up your sales and have to pay a tax on your sales, it sends a message to any businessman. This state doesn't really appreciate business. But you go on there, we're the eighth most regulated state in America. There's licensing for everything. There's a hassle anytime you want to start a business in this state, and we've got to fix that. Obviously I'm not running to do anything about that because I'm running for federal office.
Right.
But it's just common sense. The aids that we have for businesses, Jobs Ohio and whatnot. Almost totally political organizations, where decisions are made on the basis of who you are rather than what you're trying to do. And I've faced that. I've been an investment banker my whole career, I've done transactions where we could have used the assistance of state programs to help assist in capital or location, whatnot. They're comfortable with doing the sure thing, but they're not comfortable with assessing risk and helping start companies that are in the early stages. And it's supposed to be effectively a venture fund, and venture funds should have the capability of assessing those kinds of risks, and they don't. They stay away from it.
Well, I think one could easily take out the word or the state Ohio and put, the United States in its place, I suppose. And
yes.
I presume these same principles would apply, at least insofar as the regulatory environment in the United States. I think it's very Trumpian in the idea that if you reduce regulation, business and industry prosper and flourish. It's not something magical. I mean, it's very common sense that...
It's all common sense. You're right.
Well, then what of the tax code? Hearing your comments about taxes, the idea that the Biden administration wants to tax unrealized capital gains would be just absolutely devastating. What is your proposal to deal with the tax code, which is just really, it is impossible to understand, and it is there really for the benefit of these large influential businesses. Those with the lobbying dollars seem to get the best love from the IRS in the form of the tax code. How do we transform that?
That infects health care. It affects everything.
Yes, sir.
It affects our entire economy. And, we're set up with kind of a pay-to-play kind of crony capitalism that we've got to get rid of. And I think, Donald Trump actually recognized that. And a lot of that, first of all, I would immediately move to create some distance between somebody serving in office and becoming a lobbyist. Lobbyists are one of the major reasons why we have the deficits we have.
Well,
is it the lobbyists that are the fault, or is it the politicians who really don't know anything about what they're legislating, that they have to rely on quote-unquote experts, which typically come from the lobbying industry, who actually write the legislation and hand it to the elected official?
It's right. It's a no-win situation for America. There's no doubt about it. And you know, and those kinds of things, we need to not send people to Washington to get rich. And we had a forum last night in your neck of the woods. And in fact, I was there pretty late. And those are the kinds of questions we talked about. We need to get crony capitalism out of our system. And any president that comes in or any legislator that is elected, that should be their biggest effort, not to regulate more, but to get rid of the customs and policies that allow ex-politicians to quit their job as a legislator and get rich, or get rich while they're in office, unfortunately. I mean, when you see people like Harry Reid that went in with modest net worths, come out with hundreds of millions of dollars in net worth. Insider trading should be completely eliminated on the part of anybody in office. As was said last night, Nancy Pelosi is one of the best stock pickers in America.
Yeah. She's got a lot of help surrounding her with that one, I'm certain. Let us dive into a specific issue. And I have struggled mightily to try to figure out where in the hell the Biden administration is on this, but it doesn't even appear to know. Price of oil, it is necessarily going to increase, the gallon of gas. We were told that by Barack Obama because of the environmental question, this whole idea of the global warming or climate change. That is an overlay for left-wing politicians. Once they meet reality, in other words, when the price of gasoline starts to go up as a consequence of their policies, they struggle to do something temporarily to fix the political problem they face. They have released 50 million barrels of oil, like 3 days' worth of supply. The Russians and the Saudis responded by curbing their production, meaning it did absolutely nothing. We also sold one-third of it to foreign countries, so we didn't even get the benefit of all of it. Now, how do you reconcile what the Biden administration is attempting to do with the whole idea that overlaying this, and it's not going to go away, this global warming thing? Where are you on that as it relates to our economy and what we really truly need to do, if anything?
You know, we need to address it. Half of America has been convinced that that carbon's the problem. If you really start looking at it, you know, the solution's one of two things. So we can go back to the Stone Age, because that's what a lot of Democrats are proposing,
true,
whether they say it or not.
True.
Or we can deal with it, as it comes along. Climate has been changing throughout the history of the world.
Indeed.
And it's going to change, going to continue to change. And we'll see what happens. A lot of the warnings that they put out over the last many years, you certainly remember Al Gore saying in 10 years we're going to be awash. But when you see Barack Obama buying a house at an elevation of a couple of feet in Martha's Vineyard and paying, tens of millions of dollars for his residence, obviously he's not too worried about it, and he's supposed to be the climate change president. Or what was supposed to be the climate change president.
Right.
It's political. It's noise. It's an attempt to gain power. It's an attempt to globalize the world. And the reality is that we depend upon petroleum products for everything, for pretty much everything.
Yeah.
Not only does it power our means of transportation, but virtually everything we use in modern society has some link to petroleum products. And what our genius administration has done is basically make it a lot more expensive. And they did it, a lot of their actions send a message to energy producers to cut back on production, because you're not going to be welcome with increasing your production right now. And the result is higher prices. And it's, again, common sense. There is no common sense in the Biden administration.
Well, and I would argue it is the intended result. I mean, that is exactly what they are hoping for. I go back to Barack Obama's statement. In order to get you off of the addiction to gasoline, we need to make it, well, outrageously expensive. It's like increasing taxes on cigarettes to get people to quit smoking.
That's right. Right. And not only that, but he's hurting the people that he claims he's interested in helping.
Yes.
And there's just no common sense to it. We're dependent upon gas engine vehicles right now. And, you know, I was just playing around with some numbers. And you know, it's for the average person that drives 30,000 miles a year, which if you have a long commute or you're a business person that uses your car, is not an unusual number. You know, it's costing you an extra $125 a month. You know, inflation is worst on those that can least afford it. And the Biden administration, through its spending, you know, inflation is, you know, too many dollars chasing too few goods. And not only that, but they're attempting to have more inflation. And, you know, this new modern monetary theory that is espoused by the left is a ridiculous approach to economics.
Yeah.
And, you know, their idea is you can spend as much as you want as long as we remain the world reserve currency. Well, there's plenty of proposals, and the Chinese are pushing it. And we're not going to be the world reserve currency much longer. I mean, there's too much power with the Chinese right now in almost every international organization. And we better get ready for this. And the way to get ready for it is get our spending under control and not do things that we want, just do things that we need. And we're not there right now.
Well, that's a novel concept. How about that? Minding the dollars. I can't imagine, especially a successful businessman, not embracing that concept. Before we part company, Mike Gibbons, and I'm hoping that we'll talk again in advance of the primary. The existential threat that we face from China, I think more notably than Russia, but also they seem to be getting away with, murder. I mean, you got the Ukraine situation with Russia. We don't seem to be doing anything about it. And then China with the South China Sea, both nations are testing these hypersonic nuclear weapons, and we seem to have a disadvantage strategically on those. What's your take on those existential threats, Mike?
Well, you know, I believe in peace through strength. I think we have such a formidable military that nobody questions our superiority, and we have Democrat administrations that every chance they get, they cut back on military spending. Now, you know, there's a lot of inefficiencies there.
Thank you.
But
yes.
We should be pursuing the most advanced weapons, you know, at all times. And the fact that China could beat us, probably with our own designs, by the way.
Yeah.
They probably stole our design.
Yes.
And we need to get there. And I have a son that's a Navy pilot, and I felt really good about him when Donald Trump was president, because I knew he wouldn't do anything stupid. And we have a president right now that frankly, I don't think I know as a parent of a combat pilot that I don't like the fact that he is as unknowledgeable and is completely out of touch as he actually is. And it's pretty scary being a dad. Right,
I suspect. Well, thank you for your son and his service to our country, and pass that along for my listeners. We could talk all day, and I think I have a really firm handle on where you probably are on immigration as well, considering the open border. I'll just recommend my listeners head on over to gibbons4ohio.com. It's a very comprehensive page. You can read about the various issues, immigration, health care, taxes, the Second Amendment. You're a gun club a member as well.
Number,
as I am.
Yeah.
Maybe we get to shoot sometime. So when you're in town.
I wish I had more time now, Brian.
No doubt about it. Well, we'll make more time. We'll have you back on again. Mike Gibbons, best of luck to you as we head to the primary. Again, you're welcome to be on the 55 KRC Morning Show to talk more about the issues. And between now and that time, the best of health to you and your family.
Thanks for having me, Brian.
My pleasure, Mike. Take care of yourself.